Live from San Diego, California, it's theCUBE. Covering Cisco Live US 2019. Brought to you by Cisco and its ecosystem partners.
Welcome back here in the San Diego Convention Center. I'm Stu Miniman, my co-host Dave Vellante, and you're watching theCUBE, the leader in worldwide tech coverage, and at Cisco Live 2019. Happy to welcome back to the program one of our CUBE alums, Russ Curry, who is the Vice President of Enterprise Strategy at NetScout. Russ, great to see you. Thanks for joining us.
Great to see you guys too. Thanks for having me.
All right, we always say we got a bunch of Massachusetts guys that had to fly all the way across the country to talk to each other.
Really, what the heck, huh?
So a couple hours for the bees tip off. Right. Everybody's excited, but a lot of excitement here in the DevNet zone specifically, and Cisco Live overall, 28,000 in attendance. You've been doing a lot of customer meetings. Give us a little insight. What's been your takeaway from the show so far?
Yeah, I think that there's a real lot of energy towards the multi-cloud, cloud deployments in general, security. The whole introduction of Umbrella has got a lot of conversation started. It's amazing the amount of companies that you see out there talking about just visibility in general, and us being one of them as well. So. It's been a lot of fun. Good show this year.
Yeah, Russ, I've been looking forward to this conversation. We heard from Chuck Robbins in the keynote. He said the network sees a lot of things, and Cisco says they're going to give customers that visibility. Of course, that ties in a lot to what NetScout did. Love, you know, give us, you know, your thoughts on multi-cloud. How's Cisco doing in the space, and how does NetScout fit into that whole picture?
Well, I think one of the things that, as Chuck talks about that, it's the cloud is the one thing, or the network is the one thing that's common for all the devices, right? If I go into a different cloud, I have one set of performance metrics I might be able to gather. If I look at a device or an operating system, it's all different. But all the communications on the network, TCP/IP is common. And it really provides that thread that you're able to provide that level of visibility. So it really becomes one of those things that the network is a unique place to gain perspective on both the performance and the security that we're delivering to our customers.
So can you just summarize the problem that NetScout solves for our audience?
Sure. I think that primarily it's one of these situations where in my on-prem environments, it was pretty easy. I had access to everything. I could see what was going on quite readily. I started to introduce visualization, and now traffic started to move much more east-west and became a problem for folks. I think Cisco recently said 85% of the traffic they're seeing on the network is east-west traffic, right? And then we move to the cloud, and it's even more obfuscated. I can't see anything in ways of network traffic there, typically. Though the cloud vendors are starting to address that. But really being able to gain that level of visibility so you can understand exactly what's happening. Just gaining that perspective.
So let's explain that. Why? I'm going to stay with the east-west, north-south metaphor. Why is it easier to get visibility in a column than it is a row?
I think because in a column, everything's floating north and south. So you've got everything right there, and usually you have a place where you can look into it. But when you're flat, it starts to become really different. You're looking at devices talking to other devices that don't necessarily have to traverse any part of the network. It can stay within a hypervisor, for example. So providing solutions that allow you to gain visibility into that environment is really important. And the protocols that we use there change a bit. So traditional tools don't necessarily fit well.
So what's the general solution to solving that problem? And then I want to understand the NetScout secret sauce. But let's start sort of high level. How does the industry solve that problem?
So the industry has been trying to solve that problem mostly by looking at the goodwill of third parties, looking at things like NetFlow or log events and aggregating that and normalizing it. You've had solution sets that looked at network traffic, but it becomes very difficult for a lot of folks to make use of that network traffic. And what we've done is really provide the ability to look into that network traffic and gather it from really anywhere it's deployed, whether it's public cloud, private cloud, our solution set, that's our secret sauce. Our solution set can go anywhere.
So add some color to that in terms of you're able to inspect deeper through what, just magic software, or you got a probe that you send in? Or?
So, well actually we have a device, it's called ISNG, and in the virtual world we use something that we call vSTREAM. In the physical world we have something that we call InfiniStream NG. And that leverages a technology that we've developed called ASI, which is adaptive service intelligence. And what it allows us to do is watch all that traffic and build metadata in real time so we can surface key indicators of performance and security events, get that information up into a collection mechanism that doesn't have to normalize that data, it just looks at it as is. And we build it into a service context, services context that allows users to see across that multi-cloud environment in a single pane of glass.
Okay, so Russ, one of the biggest challenges for customers is as they're changing these environments, it's what happens to their applications. You know, applications used to be rather self-contained, even with the VM they might have moved some, but now we're talking about, you know, microservices architecture, multi-cloud environments, there's a lot going on there. You know, what's the impact on that for your world?
Right, that's been exactly it, right? A three-tier application was kind of pretty straightforward, even though at the point we started introducing them, we thought that was really tough stuff. Now what we're doing, as you say, is doing microservices architectures, and I might take my presentation layer and put out in the cloud, in the public cloud in particular, so I'm closer to the end user and delivering better high performance capabilities to them, lower latency and the like. And then I take my application server, and then I split that up all over the place. And I might put some in public cloud, I might put some in private cloud, I maintain some of it in the legacy. So all that interconnection, all that interdependency is really, really hard to get your hands around. And that complexity, we looked at an ESG study that said 94% of 600 respondents said that the networks are as complex or more complex than they have been 2 years ago.
Yeah, that's not surprising, unfortunately, right, to hear that, but you know, when we talk to customers out there, it used to be, you know, the network is something, you set it up, you turned all your knobs, and then said, don't breathe on this thing, because I've got it just where I want. Today, it can't be like that.
No.
You know, we know that it's very dynamic, it has to change. The message from Cisco has been, we need to simplify things, and you know, obviously everybody wants that, but how do you make sure you ensure that application performance and security without having the poor admins have to constantly, you know, be getting tickets and dealing with things?
I think our solution really provides that common framework for visibility, and that's really what I think is really important. When you're starting to infer based upon different data sets, it becomes very difficult to put your finger on a problem and identify that's really the problem. And IT, it's trying to blend the organization, looks at this concept of the versatilist and trying to make sure that people are more capable in addressing problems in kind of a multi-dimensional role that they have now. In particular, network and security, the organizations that are trying to come together, they rely on different data sets, and that's where it kind of falls apart. If you have a common data set, you're going to have a better perspective.
Okay.
I was just, from that application standpoint, how much of this is just giving notifications and visibility into it versus, you know, is it giving recommendations or even taking actions along those lines?
Yeah, I think it has to give you recommendations and it has to give you pinpoints. You've got to be able to say, here's the problem, this is what you need to do to fix it, right? I think often when I'm talking to folks, I say, it's about getting the right information to the right person at the right time to do the right thing. And if you're able to do that, you're going to be much more effective. You know?
Yeah, so you've got this early warning system essentially, or hopefully not a too late, but that's what IT practitioners want.
Right.
Give me a gap and tell me the action to take before something goes wrong, ideally. And so you can do that, you can give them visibility on it, kind of pinpoint it, and do you see the day, Russ, where you can use machine intelligence to, as Stu was suggesting, start to maybe suggest remedial action or even take remedial action?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, there are some things that you can really do and do quite well. Blocking for security events, for example, is a primary one. We've always had the IDS in place, and in the early days, a lot of folks were cautious because they didn't want to have a negative impact on the business. But when we take a look at exfiltration and blocking outbound connections, if you know the bad actors and you know the bad addresses, you can stop that before it gets out of your network, so people aren't going to have that exfiltration of your information.
All right, so Russ, you've been meeting with a bunch of customers here at the show. What's top of mind for them? I know some of the conversations I've been having this week, you know, security, you know, has been climbing that list for many years now, but in your world, what are some of the top issues?
Yeah, security definitely, there's no question. I think it's one of those environments where you can almost never have enough. They're always hungry for more and more and better and more accurate solutions. I think I saw something recently that was the top 125 security solutions. It's like, top 125, really? You know, so
We've boiled it down to 125.
Exactly. And I think IDC's taxonomy has 73 subcategories to security. So security is, you know, more than a $500 word. You know, it might be a $5,000 word. It's crazy. Okay. And same with cloud, right? Because it's not like you need, in fact, I was talking to someone recently, and it's, where'd the cloud village go? It's not a cloud village anymore. This is, everything we're doing is the cloud. So it's a change in mindset. So it's interesting.
Yeah, it's a cloud universe. So what's next for NetScout? You know, give us a little roadmap. What can observers expect coming from you guys?
A more significant push into security in particular. One of the things we see is that our data set really has the ability to be leveraged for both security and performance workflows. We're integrating the products that we bought with the Arbor acquisition. We bought Arbor Networks, and they have a highly curated threat intelligence feed that we're going to bring in and add to our InfiniStreams and have the ability to detect problems deep inside the network. You know, it's one of these things, the bad actors kind of live off the land. They get in there and they move their way around slowly and methodically and dribble information out. Well, the only way to catch that is by continually monitoring the network. So having that perspective, so continuing to grow that out and provide, again, more of that AI ML approach to understanding and be more predictive when we see things and be able to surface that type of information.
Yeah, so security, right, it used to be hacktivists, and then now it's become, you know, high crime, you know, even you know, nation states.
Right.
And the job of a security technology company is to raise the cost, lower the value, right, to the hacker,
right,
you know, to the infiltrator, so that they go somewhere else.
Right.
Right. Make it really expensive for them to either get through, but maybe once they do get through, make it really hard for them to take stuff out. And that's exactly really what you're doing.
Yeah, it was like you made sure to lock the front door, not because it stopped them, but you know, maybe I'll go somewhere else, but
right,
it's
exactly
a little bit harder.
Knock on a different
right
door.
You
right
want to prevent them, and you want to minimize your risk, right? So if you're able to minimize your risk, both from performance and security problems, it's really all about understanding what you've got, what your assets are, protecting them, and then when someone's trying to look at them, stopping it from happening.
Okay, last question I have for you, Russ, is being in this Cisco ecosystem out there, we're watching Cisco go through its transformation, become more and more software company, now 4 years into the Chuck Robbins era. So, you know, how's that going, and what's it mean to partner with Cisco today?
It's going really well, and I think that we've adopted a lot of what Cisco has done as well, and really transformed NetScout from what was primarily a hardware-first company into a software-first company. You know, it's kind of, I was in a conference once and we were talking about software eating the world, right? But ultimately it's hardware that's doing the chewing, right? So I think it's one of those balancing acts. You know, Cisco still is selling a ton of hardware, but it's the software solution sets that they deploy on their hardware that makes it happen. And it's similar for us. You know, we're building out software solutions that really address the issues that people have building out these complex environments.
All right, Russ Curry, congratulations on all the progress there, and look forward to keeping up with how Netscape's moving forward in this multi-cloud world.
Thank you.
All right, we'll be back with lots more coverage here from Cisco Live San Diego. For Dave Vellante, I'm Stu Miniman. Lisa Martin's also here. Thanks as always for watching theCUBE.